Today, I'm in the midst of 30 buildings that span over 700 years of architectural history. But I'm not in a village, and I'm not in a market town. And I'm not where you may think I am. So where am I? Find out in just a moment. Today's selection of country houses leaves one couple lost for words.
What's going through your minds at this point?
Stunned.
And we might just have found the right house for them.
Purpose built for us, I think.
Yeah. I've bought it.
Yeah.
Today I'm in Worcestershire and this is Avoncroft Museum of Historic Buildings. Since the 1960s, they've been on a mission to rescue, relocate and preserve buildings of historical importance from across the Midlands. You'll find a medieval townhouse from Bromsgrove, 14th century roofing from part of Worcester Cathedral, right through to a Victorian counting house that was rescued from the local cattle market. Later on in the show, I'll be taking a look at the latest renovation project to have the wind put back in its sails. But first, let's take a look at what this wonderful county has to offer.
Situated in the Midlands region of England, Worcestershire shares borders with six counties, including Shropshire to the northwest and Herefordshire to the west. Winding its way through fertile farmland, the Severn is the longest river in Britain, passing through Worcestershire towns and villages, including Bewdley and Upton. Some of Worcestershire's most stunning vistas are found around the Malvern Hills, an area of outstanding natural beauty, crisscrossed by around 100 miles of bridle ways and footpaths. The landscape is said to have inspired Edward Elgar, who spent much of his life here. A statue of the composer is located in Great Malvern, a town that was also once a popular spa resort with the Georgians and Victorians. Historically believed to have healing properties, the local water flows from natural springs dotted around the town to this day. Georgian and Victorian architecture sits beside medieval gems, including the Abbey Gateway, home to Malvern's Museum. With such a wealth of classic English landscape and historic interest, it's little wonder that Worcestershire is a popular place for both a temporary and more permanent country escape.
The good news is that Worcestershire as a whole is affordable. The average cost of a detached house here is around £280,000, just a few thousand pounds shy of the national average. But when you delve a little deeper, you'll see that there's an east-west divide when it comes to price. East carries a premium because of its easy access to motorways and also to Birmingham, which makes it ideal with commuters. If you're looking for more from your property pound and you don't mind going more rural, then west is best, towards the borders of Shropshire and Herefordshire. So let's meet the couple who are hoping to call this county home.
Lee, a retired fireman, and Jane, a nurse from the city of Birmingham, first got together over an unfortunate encounter at a post-rugby match party.
I think it was coming to the end of the night and had a few beers. I tried to put my pint in an alcove. I thought it was a shelf, but I think it was Jane's head. And then it just soaked her. And so we agreed to meet, and I think I was going to pay for the
dry cleaning.
Yeah. Yeah.
Obviously, I don't like a beer shampoo very often. But he's quite a charming character when we met up.
Lee's charms led Jane to accept his proposal of marriage, and the couple went on to set up home and raise three children in the city where they were born and bred. But once again, a rugby event, this time in neighbouring Shropshire, intervened in their lives and opened their eyes to pastures new.
I think the major turning point for us was when we went to an away match for the rugby match, when we travelled down to Ludlow. I've never, ever been to Ludlow. And we were just absolutely stunned by the countryside, what's out there. It's amazing. 10 miles outside Birmingham, it's a different world.
I think we've done Birmingham.
Yeah. To death.
So with their horizons broadened, and once their children had flown the nest, they began planning their country escape. and the three-storey family house they've called home for two decades has recently gone on the market.
The move to the countryside will be a new challenge. It'll be something different, somewhere different to explore. We can go out for a walk, we can discover new things.
I'd like now that little bit of quiet.
And to make that move, Lee and Jane want a countryside location with easy access to family and their beloved grandchildren, who are all back in Birmingham.
We're looking really to move towards Worcester, maybe Shropshire area, and we need to be within probably an hour of my workplace currently, and also so we can get back if the children need us. It's the ideal time now to just do what we wanted to do, and that's get out of the city completely.
Now, with their own house sold and buyers waiting to move in, the need to find themselves a new home is more urgent than ever.
We put this house on the market to go after one particular property, and then we were gazumped. Four properties, we've been gazumped.
And we are due to be homeless in about 2 weeks' time. So really, we are desperate now to move.
Jane and Lee are focusing their attention on Worcestershire, but will also consider areas of Shropshire that are within an hour's drive of Jane's nursing job in Dudley. But before we start looking at properties, I'm meeting them in the Worcestershire countryside to find out more about the home they'd like to live in.
Welcome to Worcestershire. I wanted to bring you up to the beautiful Clent Hills. It's such a gorgeous part of this county. I'd like to know what the two of you envisage when you think of your new home here in Worcestershire.
Smaller than the one we've got. At the moment, we've got a whole floor that we don't use.
Yeah.
And it's time to move and make a much smaller place.
What about the style of the property, the number of bedrooms, the living space?
Right, a minimum of two bedrooms, ideally, but three would be nice for when the children come to stay. A nice-sized garden, so when they do come, we can put them outside.
An office, maybe. Just something that, when you walk in, it's different, and there's that little surprise around the corner.
So are you looking for a property that you can literally just move into, put your slippers on and relax in, or are you happy to knock down a few walls, do some renovations?
I really would like to put our own stamp on the property. Anything, new kitchen, new bathroom, an outbuilding to do up, take your pick.
Oh, you mentioned a workshop. Is that going to be your man cave then, Lee?
I do like doing a bit of pottery. And I really do fancy a lathe. I fancy doing a bit of wood turning.
So would the money for the renovations need to come from within the budget, or is that an extra pot?
£410,000 on the property, and then we'll save up. Not a problem.
Yeah.
Well, £410,000 is a very healthy budget for this part of the county. How flexible are you about the location?
We have looked a lot round North Worcestershire, but we have seen places also across the border in Shropshire. I'd be more than happy to go across and look at those, yes.
We've got some brilliant properties to show you. Ready to look?
We are.
Can't wait.
Come on, let's go.
OK.
For a maximum budget of £410,000, Lee and Jane would like two or three bedrooms with space for an office and a garden to play with the grandchildren in. Lee is after a workshop for his pottery and wood turning, and they're both happy to do a bit of work to make the house their own. We've found some fantastic properties to tempt them with, and I'll be getting them to guess the price at each before I reveal it. The final stop on our search will be the mystery house, which could really make these downsizers assess their plans. Our house hunt is heading 45 miles southwest of Birmingham, 8 miles northwest of Worcester, to the village of Martley. Located in the Malvern Hills district of Worcestershire, the village features a pub that was once a coaching inn, and a Norman church, one of the first in the country to have six bells, cast locally in the 17th century. We're down a quiet lane a mile and a half away from the centre of the village and surrounded by fields.
This is the property I wanted to show you.
Beautiful. Yep.
It's, I think the words chocolate box spring to mind.
Yep. It has got the character, hasn't it?
And what about the windows?
Honeycomb.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Well, let's hope the inside lives up to these really positive first impressions. Let's go and open the door.
OK.
The cottage has deeds dating back to 1800, but may well predate this. Originally built for the poor of the parish, it's been extended over the years. Jane and Lee say they like surprises, and with a layout filled with unexpected corners, this cottage certainly delivers them. We're starting our tour in the very welcoming lounge.
So we come straight in to the old part of the house. Yeah. You can see all the character and history in here, can't you?
It's beautiful.
I do like the fireplace. It's really nice, my goodness, yeah.
There's some really beautiful old touches in here. And these beams were probably reclaimed from either a local manor house or a local church. So although they've been in here since the old part of the house was built, they've probably got a longer history than that as well. Yeah.
They fit this room perfectly.
I'm eager to look into another room or two.
That's a great reaction. Yeah. So come on, there's lots to see.
Okay.
As we leave through the back of the lounge and pass through a snug into the kitchen breakfast room, there's a feeling of hidden rooms to discover in this house.
Now do watch your step, because there are lots of different levels going on in this house. So a good sized kitchen with beautiful views out over the garden.
Mm.
Spot on the size of the kitchen.
Yeah,
plenty of space.
Yeah. That overused word potential, so it's certainly got plenty of potential. The size is superb. We could live with this for the time being.
As it is, yeah.
And then slowly do it up. So it's perfect. I just want to see more of it.
The room I do want to show you is just back over there, and it's a gorgeous sunny conservatory.
Okay.
This is one of those rooms that you're just going to be in on a cold winter's day and feel cosy and toasty, aren't you?
It's really warm in here, isn't it?
Hence, look, the oranges and the lemons growing.
Oranges, yeah.
That is wonderful.
Is this a space that you'd use, though? Or is this
probably not.
You'd...
Probably not. Probably never come here as a joking. The smile does it already. I'm loving it. It really is. It's great.
And it smiles all round as the character of this cottage has really fired up our buyer's curiosity. This floor also features a utility and separate WC just off the kitchen. And to the front, there's a dining room, currently used as a library. There's also the first of three bedrooms, currently used as a study, with its own dressing area and an ensuite bathroom. Then a staircase takes us upstairs to the remainder of the sleeping accommodation, which includes a double bedroom with a wash basin, a family bathroom, and of course the master with double aspect windows.
You might just want to take a look at the view. Could you imagine looking out over that with a cup of tea in the morning?
That's stunning. Very nice.
What about the size of the room? Because it's not a huge bedroom.
Plenty big enough. And we could probably put some freestanding furniture in and use the storage that way instead of the built-in cupboard.
I'm so pleased with how this is going. I think you're going to like the garden just as much. So let's go and explore that.
Lead on.
OK, off you go, my dear.
Outside, the cottage is surrounded by generous, secluded gardens to all sides, which, like its interior, provide many corners to explore. Filled with mature shrubs, it even has its own mini orchard. There are a number of outbuildings, including a greenhouse and shed, plus something I know Lee wants, a double garage with power and lighting, which offers plenty of scope for pottery and carpentry.
Is it too much for you? Because it's a big garden.
No.
My part-time job, this will be.
Yeah, it's got lots of different areas, hasn't it, to explore. It's beautiful.
Yeah. The shed, the greenhouse, the workshop. There's so much potential there. It's wonderful.
This seems to be going really well.
It does.
And let's hope it carries on going really well, because this is where I have to ask you to guess the price. Mm-hmm. So let's remind ourselves of the budget, £410,000. Where do you think this property sits alongside that?
Fingers crossed, would hope you get it in around 405.
Ooh. My heart wants it to be about 300. But realistically, I'm going to go for the 410.
Well, you're both off the mark, I'm afraid, and you are both under.
Oops.
It's on the market for £425,000. However, the owner has told us that they would seriously consider an offer somewhere around £410,000. So it could be potentially brought in bang on budget.
Oh, it's worth every penny.
Yep.
Even though there's a lot of work to do.
So I'm guessing you wouldn't mind going back in, having another look around? I'll come and find you in, a couple of hours or so?
Yeah.
All right. OK, thank you.
Thank you.
This enchanting character cottage may be pushing their budget, but it has all the accommodation and intrigue they're after, with lots of potential to put their own stamp on the place. There are three bedrooms, including an ensuite, a selection of versatile reception rooms, with options for an office, a beautiful garden perfect for playing with the grandkids in, a double garage giving workshop space for Lee, and it's less than an hour to Jane's job.
Even though it's oldie-worldie, it's still lots of space, and every door has got an even more surprising room behind it. It really is a lovely house.
There's so many doors and opportunities. There's a room to the left, room to the right. It's just a surprise every time you step down a step.
Unusual space. What could we use this for, Jane?
You could have a dining room or even somewhere for when the children come.
Perfect.
I think it's a cracking house, and I really can't see me and Jane living here.
Have you seen enough?
I have, yes.
I'm quite intrigued. Is this house smaller than your current house?
Nope, it's bigger.
Downsizing, anyone? Downsizing? That concept?
With some of the most fertile farmland in the country, Worcestershire is a county well suited to growing fruit. When the area was opened up in the 19th century via new canal and railway routes, orchards were planted on a large scale, and they continue to be a well-loved feature of the local landscape, as well as a haven for wildlife. As Lee and Jane are keen to find out about the heritage of the countryside, we're sending them to meet fruit farmer Jeff Thompson, whose family have been growing apples in the Teme Valley since the 1960s.
So, Jeff, what variety of apples do you grow here?
We'll have probably 10 different varieties, but we mainly grow three varieties, Yarlington Mill, Dabernet and Harry Masters Jersey, just because we know they are proven for their quality for cider making.
So are the apples here the same as your everyday eating apples, like your Cox's and Bramley's?
No, not at all. There's a complete contrast, as you'll find out if we sample some of these in the basket.
Jeff has three different apples for Jane and Lee to try. Starting with the dessert variety, Discovery.
Oh, that's nice.
That's sweet. Yeah.
You can taste a real sweetness to a dessert apple, plus there's an aroma, isn't there, to it as you bite it.
Next up, the Bramley, which is typically used for cooking.
And you're going to find a real contrast with this.
All right, thank you. Oh, no, that's a sour apple.
It's impossible to eat that one out from the face, isn't it?
Yeah. You can see why you cook with them and not eat them.
And lastly, a vintage cider apple known as the Yarlington Mill.
They're not as bitter as the other ones, but they're certainly not sweet, are they?
No.
They're very dry.
It does have juice and sweetness, but it also is high in tannin, so it gives it that totally different flavour.
Well, it's very kind of cloying in your mouth, isn't it? It's difficult to chew after a bit.
It's just ideal for making cider.
Yeah. I look forward to that.
The orchard provides 66 acres of apples for cider making here on the farm. As well as picking the best varieties to blend, it's crucial to harvest them at the right time. And that's once all the starch in the fruit has been converted to sugar. A simple test can check for this by dipping sliced apples in iodine, a chemical that turns the flesh dark if it's not yet ripe. Once the fruit is ready, it's harvested and brought in trailers to be washed and inspected before going through the mill.
It doesn't look much, but that small little box grinds more to a pulp.
The pulp then goes through a press to extract the juice, which is filtered and put into fermentation tanks.
During the whole period of harvest, between mid-October to mid-November, we will fill the whole six fermentation tanks.
How many varieties of cider do you actually make, Jeff?
We do a medium sweet, a medium dry, and then we also do a nice discovery cider, which is more like a sparkling champagne cider, and some people refer it to as a more like a apple prosecco. We better go up and try some now.
Okay. Back out in the orchard, Jeff has some samples lined up.
We'll start first with the ordinary cider.
Oh, sweet.
That is sweet.
That's
why
it's best to have this one first.
That's a nice one. I like that one. Mm.
And then the Discovery Cider.
Well, you can tell there's a lot more fizz to this.
Also known as Apple Prosecco.
Oh, it certainly brings home the dryness in the other one, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yes, much, much drier.
I quite like that one.
I'll take a case.
Yeah, it's quite different, isn't it?
Yeah.
Quite unique.
Yeah.
Mm. Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, let's see if we can find Lee and Jane something to raise their glasses to when our property search continues in the morning. Birmingham-based retired fireman Lee and his wife Jane, a nurse, have up to £410,000 to make the move into the countryside of Worcestershire or Shropshire. We've already had a good response to our house hunt.
The smile tells it all, Lee. I'm loving it, man.
But there's still more to see, including the mystery house, which could be a little grander than our rural relocators had in mind.
It does look like a manor house.
A baronial hall. Yeah.
And I'll be turning my hand to some centuries-old building skills.
I could be your daub apprentice, a daub and wattle apprentice. Well, it's a misty morning for the second day of our house hunt, and we have two more homes to show Jane and Lee. Now, later on, I'll be taking them to see the mystery house, which will challenge our DIY-loving couple. Will they find anything to do there? But first, we're doing a spot of border hopping and going to look at a house in Shropshire.
Our next property is in the small Shropshire village of Nash, an 8-mile drive east of the town of Ludlow and a 3.5-mile drive north of the ancient market town of Tenbury Wells. Lying on the Worcestershire bank of the River Teme, which marks the county boundary with Shropshire, Tenbury Wells offers a good selection of shops and amenities. The Gothic-style pump rooms were built in 1862 to house baths filled by the local water, which it was hoped would have healing properties. We're a 3.5-mile drive back in the rural location of Nash, where down a country lane, the cottage we've come to see is located.
It's pretty, isn't it?
It's absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah. Quite a nice view.
It is.
That's not bad at all, yeah.
What's going through your minds at this point?
Stunned.
It's nice again.
It's beautiful. It's the setting as well, it's just lovely.
Lee and Jane seem completely taken aback by the appearance of this detached cottage, which dates back to the 1700s, with an additional wing seamlessly added from a converted pig shed in the 20th century. We're starting through the entrance hall in the newer part of the house and head straight into the country kitchen diner.
I think it's definitely the heart of the house, isn't it?
It is. This is absolutely stunning, this kitchen.
Lots of original features, the period beams in here, and then anything new that's been added has been done really sympathetically.
Yeah. I don't think I'd change a thing in here.
No. Nothing to change. It's superb. It really is.
Are you keen to see more?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So let's step up and we'll go up into the lounge. Yeah.
Thank you.
So this is the main living room with that stunning fireplace there, and it's got the original bread oven in the side. This is really a period property, isn't it? Is it too old?
No. Very traditional. Yeah. It's beautiful, yeah.
My only concern, believe it or not, is wondering what I've got to do. What is there for me to do? I need to change something. But unfortunately, at the moment, nothing needs changing.
Funny you should say that. Just follow me.
OK.
Lee's right, the ground floor of this delightful cottage is impeccably presented. It also features a garden room with vaulted ceiling and study area around the staircase, as well as a ground floor bathroom with a bath and separate shower cubicle. But it's on the upper floor, the location of the three bedrooms, where I think Lee might find something to get his DIY teeth into.
Now, up here you have just a toilet.
Yeah.
So the main bathroom is downstairs. What you could do is take the banister forward, knock through, and put in a second family bathroom for upstairs above the downstairs existing bathroom. So there is your project.
That's enough to be going on with.
The first of the three bedrooms is a good size, currently set up as a twin with dual aspect windows. There's another double with exposed woodwork, and then the bedroom that could be Lee and Jane's.
So this is the master bedroom. It's got dual aspect, making the most of the views of the countryside that surround this property.
It's got everything, hasn't it?
Yeah.
And again, those beautiful beams that you can see.
Yeah. Done a fabulous job, haven't they?
Like everything about it is lovely.
A very positive response to the inside of this cottage. And there's more to see in the third of an acre garden. There's not only a detached garage, but a timber workshop too. With a decked terrace running over a stream, plus two patio areas, there are plenty of places to unwind and enjoy the serene surroundings, and enough gardening to keep Lee occupied.
When it comes to gardening, I'm a major potterer. Not only pottering, but certainly like pottering in the garden.
Well, this could keep you busy. Now, the other idea I had for a project is that over in the far corner, you've got a shed and a garage. Mm-hmm. There is potential for you to build something over there as well, subject to, you know, the right kind of planning permissions, mm-hmm. if they were needed, of course.
Mm, it all depends on the price there, doesn't it? So what we've got left in the coffers, in the money bank.
Your budget's £410,000. What do you think it's on for?
I think this is over our budget, and I like it too much, so I think probably you're going to say 425.
OK, Lee?
I'll go for 430.
I'm afraid you're both wrong. It's actually on the market under budget. It's on at £399,500.
That's fabulous. Mm. I've bought it.
Yeah.
OK. I'm sure you're keen to go in and have another look around, so off you go. Come and find me when you've seen enough.
Thank you.
Go on.
Coming in below budget, this charmingly presented period property could provide everything Lee and Jane are looking for. It has a welcoming country kitchen diner, the three bedrooms they've asked for, a lovely cottage garden, and there's a versatile garage and workshop. And it's all peacefully located down a quiet country lane.
Oh, this is lovely. You can just see the two little people in here, can't you?
Nice and snug. You've taken to this one, haven't you?
I have. I have, yeah.
Yeah.
Walking down the path to look at it, it's got that coming feel about it. And when you actually get in the kitchen, it's stunning. It's somewhere you could sit down and just have the whole family around the table at the same time, but also be able to see other rooms round corners. It's got character in spades, and it's stunning. This is a fabulous room, isn't it? You wouldn't think it was a later addition. It looks like it's part of the house.
No, it's wonderful. Purpose built for us, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Jane will definitely divorce me if we don't end up buying this one.
Have you seen enough?
Yeah.
How are you feeling?
Yep.
I love this one.
Do you?
Yeah.
That's good. That's the reaction we love to hear. But just hold that thought, because we're off to see the mystery house now. Mm.
Worcestershire's long history of habitation means its architectural heritage spans the centuries. But as the needs of the people living here evolve, not all of the fascinating reminders of our past are safe from dereliction and demolition. That's where the Avoncroft Museum near Bromsgrove steps in. Covering 700 years of local architecture, it's now home to 30 different buildings, all painstakingly transported from their original locations to this 19-acre site. I'm meeting Simon Carter, the director of the museum, who's agreed to show me around. And we're starting at a 19th-century windmill that was transported here in 1969 from near Arden in Warwickshire, a journey of around 30 miles.
It's quite a feat moving a windmill across a county. Who was responsible for doing that?
It was actually a group of volunteers. They took it apart in the space of 5 days, numbering all the timbers and dismantling the bricks individually, and then brought it here, and over the course of the next few years it was reassembled and brought back to working condition.
I think that's what they call a labour of love, isn't it?
It is.
And one of the volunteers who moved the mill in the 60s is here today, carrying out maintenance on the sails so it can continue to produce flour as it has done since 1977.
And this is Mike, who rescued the mill originally.
Hi. Great to see you all. Don't bang your head on there. No, I bet you've done that a few times,
very
Mike.
Very often, yes.
So, Mike, it's fair to say you're the saviour of the windmill, then?
Well, one of them, yes. There were six of us. But that was quite a few years ago, 46 years ago now, that was, actually.
Had you had any experience or a background in fixing windmills when you took that project
Certainly
on?
Certainly nothing to do with windmills. Repairing my own home, which is a timber-framed house, yes. And carpentry was my love anyway. But windmills, no. Nearest I got to windmills was sailing.
So it's been a learning curve over the years,
yes,
then.
Indeed.
How on earth do you begin to start the process of how to operate a windmill? How do you go about learning all that?
We had one book between us, which was called The English Windmill by Rex Wales. Mostly is learning the ancient crafts, the millwrighting crafts, which we've tried to apply. Even though we use modern materials and modern equipment, we try and keep it as original as possible. We had professional help as well. We had a German carpenter who was absolutely first class at this sort of structure. He did the main heavy timber construction. Beautiful work.
And what did it feel like when you sliced that first chunky slice of bread from the loaf baked from your flour?
To think that we'd actually put something together that did produce proper wholemeal flour, and to bake a loaf and eat the first sandwich with a bit of homemade jam. Perfect.
The museum currently has 140 volunteers like Mike, and much of their work involves keeping skills alive that might otherwise be lost. Another building undergoing restoration is a timber-framed 15th century merchant's house. In 1962, it was the first structure brought here, rescued from demolition in the centre of Bromsgrove. Half a century later, maintenance man Mike has the ongoing job of looking after the panels using a technique known as wattle and daub.
So, Mark, were you a dab hand with daub before you started working here?
No, I worked with a chap who worked here for 30 years. He taught me how to do it.
So have you managed to pass this technique on to anybody else yet, Mark?
Oh, yeah, but they've left most of all.
So you need some willing apprentices,
yeah.
I could be your daub apprentice, a daub and wattle apprentice for the...
Would you like a go? Shall we have a go?
Listen, my dad's a builder. He'd be very disappointed if I didn't have a go.
Hazel twigs are woven together to form the wattle, filling the gaps between the timber frame.
They're literally just built of sections that would have been fitted on site like this, is that...?
If you're from an area where there's not a natural stone material, timber is the obvious choice. By only putting the frame up and making the infill out of cheaper and more replaceable material, you've got a kind of quick way of filling in your wall space.
Once the wattle work is done, a mixture called daub is applied.
Even the name daub sounds great, doesn't it?
It does, but you might not enjoy working with it if you knew what it originally had in it. Usually it not only have had clay and straw, that it would have had cow or pig dung in it.
Nice! None in now.
We haven't put any in today, no.
But it's still got the horsehair in, it's got the straw in.
It has.
It's really sticky, isn't it?
Now to get daubing.
How's it looking, Mark? I'm not sure I've got your smoothness of touch, I'm afraid.
It seems all right to me. It's good for a first attempt.
Well, hopefully that will make my dad proud. And it's been inspiring to see how much care and effort is going into preserving our historic buildings. For our mystery proposition, we're extending Lee and Jane's search area, heading around 4 miles south of the Shropshire border into the Herefordshire hamlet of Luston, 3 miles north of the town of Leominster. With a population of a little under 12,000, there are plenty of useful shops and facilities to be found here. The town features some traditional timber frame buildings, several of which are reputedly the work of John Abel, an early 17th century carpenter and mason who was granted the title of King's Carpenter. We're a 3 mile drive north in Luston, where our mystery proposition is of similar historic and eye-catching construction.
Oh dear.
Where's my spirit level?
So, this is our mystery house. And yes, you're right, you will need your spirit level.
Yeah.
Well, it's got the curb appeal, isn't it? It's got the wave factor.
I don't expect you to find something like this. You really can't take your eyes off it.
In my opinion, it's just as pretty inside as it is out. So shall we go and take a look?
Yes, please. Okay.
This impressive oak-framed semi-detached house dates to around 1640, with Victorian extensions. Arranged over three floors plus a basement, there's a lot of property to see here. So, downsizing is taking a back seat for now, and we're starting our tour in the rather magnificent dining room.
Welcome to the local manor. Yeah.
It doesn't look like a manor house.
A baronial hall. Yeah. Yeah.
The grandness from the outside is definitely carried on into the inside, isn't it? Mm. It's like a grand room.
It's grade two listing. The current owners have had it for 20 years and they have painstakingly restored it and just brought to life the original features. It's got, you know, the original stone floor, this stunning fireplace, the beams and the woodwork on the walls. Could you imagine living in it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah.
Lady of the manor here. She's got home again.
Well, Lady of the manor, I'd like to talk to you about the dining options. Keep this one in your mind and I'll take you through to what's currently the living room.
Okay.
There was a small extension done in Victorian times and that is original Victorian fireplace with the original tiles. So it's, again, a lovely sense of history, a sense of who's lived here over the centuries.
Yeah.
This is used as a living space and a part of me wondered whether actually you'd want your living space in that central area.
Actually, that would be fine as a living space for the winter months, purely because of that big fire on.
Yeah.
But we've got two living rooms and we just kind of move from one to the other as the fancy takes us.
So actually, you're quite happy not to downsize, really, aren't you? Downsizing, we haven't mentioned that for a bit, have we?
You keep showing us these houses with so many rooms.
Let's just downsize to the two living rooms. Yeah. I want to show both of you the kitchen, which again, I think is quite pretty.
Back through the dining room, the kitchen also shows this home's Victorian influence.
So this is the Victorian extension. Over there in the corner, you've got the original Victorian range and the bread oven. Mm-hmm. It's all there.
Mm-hmm. It's plenty big enough, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's not a lot to do.
Yeah.
Which is another reason why this is the mystery house.
Yeah.
Could you live with that, Lee?
Yeah, what I've seen so far.
Shall we have a wander around upstairs and see if we can find you anything to do?
Okay.
Because I don't know what you're going to do otherwise. You might have to sit down for once.
Well, this house may be short on projects, but it's not short on accommodation. There's a generous-sized basement here, plus two upper floors, providing a total of four bedrooms. On the middle floor, there's the family bathroom with a corner bath, plus a small guest bedroom, and then the room that's just for them.
And into the master bedroom. It's fair to say that it befits the rest of the house downstairs, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Never been in anything like this before. I think it's just a bit grand, isn't it?
Could you imagine yourself living in anything like this?
Oh, I think so, yes.
And there's still more to show you as well.
Jane and Lee already seem pleasantly overwhelmed by the imposing scale and character of what's on offer here. But there are two more large adjoining rooms on the top floor where the historic charm raises the roof.
Good grief. This is tremendous. Oh, this is good.
Yeah, right at the top of the house, you've got a fantastic-sized bedroom in there. This could be used as another bedroom. At the moment, it's used as an office, music room. I think your grandchildren might be able to take it over with their toys.
Nope, they're not having it. It's mine. This is my favourite room in the house. I like the roof. I like the fact that it's so far off true, it's unbelievable. It's marvellous.
I think downsizing definitely has gone out the window with this one.
Yeah, it is. It's a substantial house,
absolutely.
And I need you to start thinking now about what you think this is on the market for, because the tricky part's coming up.
Okay.
Our buyers have been positively wowed by our impressive four-storey mystery house. And there's more outside in the form of a large workshop and a carport. As this house is attached at the rear, the entire garden is found to the front of the property and features mature apple trees as well as an original cider press wheel.
You've seen it all now. Are you ready to guess the price for me?
Yep, we'll give it a go.
OK, so we've got £410,000 in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
Where does this property sit alongside that?
Top of the budget, £410,000.
Now, you see, I think it's over again. I think we're going to go £420,000.
It's actually on the market for less than your budget. It's on the market for £350,000.
We'll just move into there. That's it. Yeah. I'll do us. Thank you.
You like it that much, do
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. It grows on you. It really does, doesn't it? Yeah.
Well, I think with a reaction like that, there's only one thing I could say now. Off you go, back in the house, start working out where the furniture's going. Yeah.
Thank you.
A staggering £60,000 below budget, this distinctive and historic semi-detached mystery house is certainly not a downsize for our couple. It boasts four bedrooms, two generous reception rooms, and many original features. It also offers Lee a workshop for his pottery and woodwork.
The outside, it just follows in. It's a really grand, imposing building. It's huge, like a manor house.
My favourite room, without doubt, is the top bedroom. I'd be tempted to go up there and claim it for my own, to be honest. I could definitely move into this house. I'd move in as it is today, to be honest.
Hello there. Just Hello. Checking out the local removal companies, just in case you need them.
Probably will.
Oh, OK, well, that's all the houses seen.
Yep.
Decision time. I think you've got some thinking to do, haven't you? I'm glad I'm not in your shoes. No. This has been a fantastic house hunt. You could just feel the energy building with each house we visited. I can't wait to hear what Jane and Lee have got to say. Hello, you two.
Hello.
Well, you really set us the challenge. Sweet, didn't you? Find us a house, and can you find it really quickly, please?
Yeah.
Your reactions to the properties, they just seem to get better and better. So now we're sat down, we've seen them all. Where are you at?
It was between two, and I think that's come down to one now.
There was the house just over the border into Shropshire. I got very strong positive vibes from both of you on that.
Out of them all, that's the favourite. There's enough for Lee to keep him busy. Adding a bathroom on and the workshop. And the garden will keep him busy for years, I would imagine.
There's plenty of scope to get stuck into that one, and I could have lost myself for days in there.
So now, what's your plan?
Second visit, and I'm going to do the drive in real life to see how far it is to work. And all being well, we'll put an offer in on that one.
Yep, we'll proceed with that.
Yep.
Well, that's brilliant. We're keeping our fingers crossed for you. Let us know how you go on, and we wish you lots of luck.
We will do.
Thank you.
Now, when we started this house hunt, Jane and Lee challenged us to find them a house and find it quickly. And not only have we been able to do that, but we've also managed to fulfil our DIY-loving couple's dreams of finding a renovation project. Join me next time on Escape to the Country.
Sadly, the sale of Jane and Lee's home in Birmingham fell through yet again. So they've decided to put the move on hold for the time being. If you would like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Scotland or Northern Ireland and need our help, please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.